that sounded like me. Then it said they didn't care what drug I used, and the only requirement for membership is the honest desire to stop using. I thought, well, maybe, just maybe they would let me stay. I started going to a meeting every day, or I talked with another addict. The members told me they needed me, and I began to feel a part of. I attended regularly and tried to support new meetings. I learned about the steps and I tried to work them. I didn't use, I took inventories, I made amends, and I prayed. That's one of the things I'm grateful for, is having the freedom to have a God as I understood him. One day I realized I was being free from my addiction. The obsession and the compulsion were no longer the dominating force in my life. Growing spiritually was. I got a sponsor and I talked to her. I listened to others who had clean time. I watched others, hoping I could learn from their mistakes, like what happens to people who don't go to meetings. I learned about spiritual principles, honesty, open-mindedness, willingness, humility, gratitude, forgiveness, and love. I slowly grew to accept myself, to love myself, and to love others. I'm still growing in these areas. I heard it shared, I am able to love others, for I know I am loved. NA has given me the love I needed to grow. I worked on being willing and on helping others. I learned about service work. It started with picking up ashtrays, giving members rides to 184 Narcotics Anonymous. Meetings, cleaning up after meetings, to being secretary of a group and taking meetings to institutions. I've learned that being of service is a way to show my gratitude to NA for saving my life. I feel real privileged to be clean today. I'm 20 years old now and I've been around the program for over 2½ years. Some days are better than others and other days, all I can do is hang on with both hands. I've learned that it's on my bad days that I can grow the most. I just keep on believing that it'll all be right as long as I don't use. I still do the same things I did in the first year of my recovery. I say, please, in the morning, thank you, at night, go to meetings, read the literature, look the steps, and talk to other addicts. Thanks to NA, one of my greatest joys was the day I realized that just for today, I never have to use again. Written in 1980. I can't do any more time 185. I can't do any more time. I came to the Fellowship of Narcotics Anonymous as an addict, out of an institution for women. I came the first night I got out, and it's been here that I've learned how to live, so that it hasn't been necessary for me to use any kind of drugs in my daily life. It has been here that I've learned a lot about myself, because the addicts are so very much alike. I've always seen another side of myself whenever problems and suggested solutions have been discussed at our meetings. I have learned, from those who are following the program of recovery to the best of their ability, how I can do the same if I am willing to make the effort. I have also learned from those who have made mistakes. I feel bad when I see that some leave this fellowship to try the old way again, but I know that I don't have to do that if I don't want to. Also, it has not been necessary for me to steal or to write any bad checks. My addiction goes way back. I was drinking abusively when I first started at 16, and I realized today that the reason for that was I was sick to begin with. I had this emotional illness and it was very deep. I don't think that if I hadn't been emotionally ill to begin with, that I would have gotten carried away with musing. When it became noticeable that I was using alcohol more and more, being in the nursing profession, I tried experimenting with other drugs. It grew and became a horrible problem. Although this is certainly a suicidal path in itself, when I was aware and in a lucid moment, I did realize I was hopelessly addicted. I did not know that there was any answer. There really wasn't at that time. I was in San Francisco, not knowing which way to turn, when I tried suicide and was unsuccessful. I was 26 years old at that time. I now think that if it had been possible for me, I would have come to this program at that same age as a lot who are here today. My pattern, however, continued. I had lost not only my self-respect but the respect and love of my family, my children, and my husband. I had lost my home and my profession. Somehow or other, I hadn't reached the point where I wanted to try this way of life or to try it all the way. I just had to. 185. 186 Narcotics Anonymous. Go on and try in my own way. I tried drugs again and was finally committed to another institution 3 times. The last time I went there I just felt that I couldn't do any more time. I didn't immediately connect it with my addiction. I just couldn't do any more time. It wasn't a thought, I can't use drugs, just, I can't do any more time. I just felt completely hopeless and helpless and I didn't have any answers. All of my emotional and spiritual pride had gone. I'm sure that when I was in the institution they doubted my sincerity in ever wanting to do anything about my problem. However, I did want to do something about it, and I know that this program doesn't work until we really do want it for ourselves. It's not for people who need it but for people who want it. I finally wanted it so bad I knocked on doors of psychiatrists, psychologists, chaplains and anywhere I could. I think one of my counselors, who just naturally loves all people, gave me a lot of encouragement, for I thoroughly took my first 3 steps. I admitted I was powerless over my addiction, that my life was unmanageable. I had tried so many other things, so I decided a power greater than myself could restore my sanity. To the best of my ability I turned my life and my will over to the care of God as I understood Him, and I tried in my daily life to understand God. I had read all kinds of metaphysical books. I agreed with them and thought they were great, but I never took any action on them. I never tried any faith in my daily living. It's amazing how after I had gotten just this far, I began to get a little honesty and could see myself as I was. I doubted that I could get honest, but I became aware of myself by looking outside myself at the addicts around me, by getting to know them and understand them, by being friendly with them. I would like to give credit where credit is due, and I do believe that my daily attendance at psychotherapy groups with very understanding psychologists helped me become aware of myself so that I might do something about my problem, but when I came out, I thought, oh, can I make it outside? So many times institutions took so many years out of my life that I wondered if I could stay clean and do ordinary things. I doubted whether I could go ahead with just normal living, but God has seen fit to see that I have been provided. idea of going back to my profession, which is nursing. I have since reconsidered this and am now in the process of perhaps returning to full-time nursing. With the help of some very understanding people I have met, the future here looks very bright. In the meantime, I give myself to my job every day, as best I can, and have been doing it successfully, despite the fact that when I left the institution for the last time everyone thought I was unemployable. To me this is a spiritual program and the maintenance and growth of a spiritual experience. Without the kind of help and the therapy of one addict talking to and helping another, I know that it wouldn't have been possible for me. The obsession to use drugs has been completely removed from me during this period, and I know that it's only by the grace of God, I now give my attention to my daily problems. It's amazing, having had a pattern of fear, anxiety, resentment and self-pity, how much of this too has been removed. No longer do these sway my life. I ask for help every morning and I count my blessings every night, and I'm real grateful that I don't have to go through the sickness that accompanies the taking of drugs of any kind. I think one of the biggest things that helped me here was that this is a program of complete abstinence. I got over the idea that I had a cool problem. I don't have a problem with this drug or that drug. I have a living problem, and this is all I need to think about today. I got a lot of help from my sponsor when it seemed that everyone had let me down, both family and friends. I don't know what I would have done had it not been for the doors that she opened in her letters. She shared her experience, her strength and her hope with me, and it was very beneficial. She continues to be my very good friend. Here in NA, I have found a family, friends, and a way of life. My own family has also been restored to me through working these steps, and not through directly working on the problem. A lot of wonderful things have happened to me. I can't conceive of anything ever happening that would make me want to forget this way of life. 188 Narcotics Anonymous. Bad addict. I am an addict. I used at least 50 different types of drugs on an ongoing basis for a period of 18 years. I didn't know it when I started using. But I used drugs only for one reason, because I didn't like the way I felt. I wanted to feel better. I spent 18 years trying to feel different. I couldn't face the everyday realities of life. Being a fat kid, fat all my life, I felt rejected. I was born in Arizona in 1935 and I moved to California in the early 1940s. My family moved around from state to state and my father was married several times. He was a binge drinker. Either he was in a state of self-righteousness or a state of complete degradation. This is one of the many reasons we moved so often. As I moved from school to school, I would relate various experiences that I had and I would talk about my various stepmothers. For some reason, I was thought to be a liar. It seemed the only company that accepted me, no matter where I went, was the so-called lower-level people, and I never felt I was a lower-level person. It made me feel like I had some self-worth by being able to look down on them. My family life was confused and painful, but a lot of sound moral values were passed on to me in my upbringing. I always made the attempt to stay employed. As a matter of fact, on most occasions, occasions I managed to be self-employed in some type of business. I was even able to maintain some civic status by belonging to fraternal organizations. I was 5 feet 5 inches tall, and weighed 282 pounds. I ate compulsively to try and handle my feelings and emotions and to make me feel better. As a matter of fact, this is how I originally got into using heavy drugs. I wanted to lose weight so desperately that I became willing to use heroin. I thought I would be smart enough not to get hooked, that I could use and lose my appetite, feel good and outsmart the game. I bounced around the country and ended up in penitentiaries and jails. This was the beginning of the end. Not only was I a compulsive overeater and remained fat, but I was also addicted to the drugs I was using. 188. Fat Addict 189. Somebody told me about the Fellowship of Narcotics Anonymous when I was in a complete stage of degradation and desperation. Having no place to go, I walked into this fellowship feeling as low as a person can feel, like there was no way out. I was completely and totally morally bankrupt. I knew nothing about spiritual values. I knew nothing about living. Life ultimately was nothing but pain on a daily basis. All I knew was to put something in me, either drugs, or to abuse sex to feel good, which just didn't do it for me anymore. I just couldn't get enough of anything. When I came to this program, I found something that I had never experienced before, total acceptance for who and what I was. I was invited to keep coming back to a fellowship that told me there were no fees or dues, that I had already paid my dues via my past life, and that if I kept coming back, I would find total freedom and a new way of life. Today, many years later, I find that I am free from addiction and compulsive overeating, and I have status in the community. I have a nice home and family, an executive position, and most of all I have a personal relationship with my God, which has made all these things possible. I am able to feel good, to feel joyful and blissful, to feel serenity, even when things are not as good as they might be. There is no question about it. I owe my life to the Narcotics Anonymous Fellowship in God. I can only extend my hope that if you too are suffering as I once was, you will practice the principles of Narcotics Anonymous, and find freedom from pain and a meaningful, prosperous life. 190 Narcotics Anonymous. Early Services. I started using and drinking when I was about 10 years old. My stepfa. There and I would go down to his boat and drink beer and smoke pot. Then he would force me to engage in homosexual acts with him. I was always very scared that he would beat me up. By age 11, my drinking had gotten worse, and he did start beating me. I finally went to my mother. She told me that we needed him to support us, for me to just do whatever he said, and don't make waves. By age 12, I couldn't take it at home anymore. I stole $100 from my mom and left home. After being gone for 3 nights, a man came up to me and asked if I wanted to earn some money. I agreed because I was almost broke by this time. I went to his house to take a shower. After I got dressed and came out, he asked if I took drugs. I said, "I like everything." We snorted some cocaine and he started taking off my pants. The next day, he took me to his friend's house. On the way there, he said, "You are going to get good money and all the drugs you want." When we arrived, movie cameras were set up and I began my career in porno films. There were also two men in the bathroom fixing heroin, and this was my first experience with heroin. By this time I had no feelings of self-worth and I did not care whom I hurt or what I did to hurt anyone else. By the time I was 14 and a half, I had my first overdose of heroin. When I got out of intensive care, it was hard for my sugar daddy to find me a recovery house. He finally got me into an adult program because he knew some people. At this program, I went to my first NA meeting. I was scared, lonely, and didn't want anything to do with anyone. At my second meeting, I threw a chair at the leader. I kept coming back for 90 days and I had to celebrate. I went out and got a fix. I thought it would be easy to get 90 days again. But after I went back out, I couldn't even get one day. I decided that I couldn't clean up where I was, so I relocated 3,000 miles away. Things got worse. I had to turn tricks to support my habit. One night, I blacked out in a club, got violent and was taken to a 190. Early services 191. Mental hospital. The doctors kept me so severely sedated that I wandered around in a shuffle. Because I was only 15, the doctors called my father, who I hadn't seen for 2 years. He came and got me. When we got into town, he dropped me off and said, "Call me sometime." At that point, I thought I might want to stop using. For the first time I can remember, I cried. I just sat at the airport and cried. I got right back into tricking and using, but I was so tired of lying, hustling, stealing, and using that I went to a meeting. I had just fixed before the meeting, but because I wanted to be accepted, I got up and said that I had 6 months clean. Then I went outside because I knew I was dying and I didn't know how to scream for help. My stepfather was at the meeting and I didn't even remember what he looked like. He followed me outside and said, "We have to get you in a recovery house." Then he looked me straight in the eye and said, "I love you." For the first time in my life I knew he cared. He then found a recovery house that would accept me. Before I got to the recovery house, however, I overdosed on barbiturates in a telephone booth while telling someone how to get to where I was so they could take me to the house. I stayed in the recovery house for 30 days. I go to a meeting every day now, and usually make 8 or 10 a week. Every morning when I get up, I look at myself in the mirror and say, "I'm okay for today. God, just for today, keep me clean." I'm almost 4 months clean, and I hurt most of the time. But today, I know that without this program, I will die. At this point in my recovery, I am actively involved in NA service. It keeps me busy and shows me a spiritual part of the program I never knew was there. I am slowly learning to trust my fellow members and know that I never have to be alone again. Today, I know there is hope. 192 Narcotics Anonymous. I felt hopeless. No one in my family ever used drugs except as prescribed by a doctor. In fact, no one in my family even drank, and I was taught that drunks and addicts could not solve their own personal and emotional problems and were moral degenerates. That's what I thought. In high school I started to use drugs because they helped me feel good about myself. I was so self-conscious and embarrassed about my looks that sometimes I just felt subhuman. I started to get high and became an overachiever to compensate for these feelings. College was a bore until I discovered pot. I became a hippie, met a girl who liked to party, and we were married. After school, I started using speed while traveling in my work. Soon the constant traveling and using caused my first wife to divorce me. This gave me a good excuse to go wild. I wanted to try every drug I could. A combination of narcotics, stimulants, and hallucinogens became my favorite. I started to lose the small business I had built up and felt guilty about what I had become, a business and social failure. I had to use something every day to obliterate my feelings of self-hatred, shame and guilt. I decided to get rich and go big time, healing between Chicago and New York. In order to finance the trip east, I set up my 15-year-old lover selling acid to her schoolmates. I began buying wholesale in the Midwest and reselling to students at a major Eastern university. Dealing drugs while traveling for business gave meaning to the words fear and paranoia. I fell in love with a woman and thought I could change for her. I thought everything would be okay. She helped me control my using and I set out to impress her. My business revived for a while, but then I began to use heavily again and things got worse. My second wife left me. My business failed. I felt hopeless. I needed to use to feel okay. I tried to stay high and began drinking heavily and daily again. I just did not want to feel anything. I didn't like me. I just wanted to escape from myself. I overdosed on synthetic narcotics and woke up in the hospital. While still in the hospital, 192. I felt hopeless. 193. I began to feel better and publicly declared my intention to stop using. I was going to enter the mental outpatient clinic, solve all the problems that I thought caused me to use hard drugs and never have to use again. Of course I continued to smoke pot and drink beer. After all, everyone I knew did. My business gradually fell back together and I had money in my pocket again. That was my downfall. I could now afford the most glamorous, non-addictive substance, cocaine. How wonderful was my new chemical lover. She made me feel so good, again and again. I began to lie, steal and overcharge my clients to get the money for my new habit. I went to several doctors, feigning symptoms appropriate to get prescriptions for large quantities of sleeping pills and sedative hypnotics. I used some of the prescribed drugs, but mostly sold them to get coke. Often, I used too much coke and was always in fear of a heart attack, but I could shoot some downs to knock me out. Eventually, I overdosed this way. Again, I wound up in the hospital. Once again I started to feel better after a few days clean in the hospital. I resolved to stop using again and agreed to get help from a psychiatrist. I tried. I told him how bad I was, how I felt about myself, and sometimes how